I think we really need to start with ground zero in terms of rock and roll. I think it probably is the very first rock and roll record. I'm not the expert, but I think that definitely there was something definitely new and driving and going on here that Dave was responsible for, heavy beat. So we're going to hear a little bit about the about this song first to put Dave and Fats on the map, the Fat Man.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen. That was the first record that Fats Domino made in Cosmo Matassa's studio.
Can you tell us about that session, how that came about?
That was the first record that Antoine and I made in Mr. Cosmo's studio. First, I'd like to say this, ladies and gents. Wouldn't be for Mr. Cosmo Matassa, I wouldn't be sitting here today. He made it possible that we could get in the studio and stay as long as we wanted. He would never get tired. And well, I'm glad he didn't, because we didn't have any money. He was always there for us, not only me, the late Lee Allen, Herbert Hardesty, not late, Fats Domino, not late, and so many others, and the great Earl Palmer, one of the greatest drummers in the world. We had everything going for us, ladies and gents, and when we heard Fats play the piano, nobody can beat him playing that type of music. He is the king. It has never really come out how great a piano player he is as a blues pianist, because everybody fell in with his voice and his 6/8, and that controlled the world. When we made the record, Mr. Cosmo Matassa said, "I think you got something." I didn't know what he was talking about. He said a million sellers, because we had only been making a little, few little records and giving them away, you know, that type of thing. This time we struck it real great. And that was the beginning of Dave Bartholomew and the great Antoine Fats Domino.
Dave, when you first saw Fats, did you think that he was going to be an international star that he became?
I'll put it this way. Playing that type of piano, I put Fats Domino with anybody in the world. That man can play some blues. Just all you got to do is just start him. It's hell to get him on the bandstand. Once you get him on the bandstand, you can't get him off. And also, ladies and gents, when he started singing, where did he get that voice from? Everybody want to know what's going on with Fats. That was authentic. It had a little bit of Creole in it, a little French. And when he said something, he meant it. Like, "I love you." Like, I first met John Broven in Germany. Next time I seen him was, he told me, "Living over here in the United States."
England, Dave, England.
Yeah, London, but I saw you in England, but the last time I saw you, I pulled off in the bus and you was in the driveway. And that's what next time I see you, now you tell me you're living in the United States. So I want to tell you that I didn't know you was a stranger in our town. Thank you so much for that, ladies and gents. Getting back to Fats, authentic, everything he's saying, and say it comes from the heart. And when he played the piano, better know that the 6/8, nobody can, they tried it, but nobody can beat him doing it. Now, if you want to really play the blues, you're putting them like in a bribe pack. He's going to upset you. So we had 19 million sellers in a row. That's what Lucha told me. That was the honor of Imperial Record Company at 6425 Hollywood Boulevard. I commuted, like, I would say, from 25, 30 years. At that time, let me make you laugh. I brought the records out there, and he said, well, you got to come out and master the records. Sure enough, went and mastered the records. The next session I had was I'm walking. He said, Dave, you got to come out here. But what you got to do, you got to get on a plane. He said, because the last time you come to a meeting, the train was 3 hours late. I mean, 3 days late, and you got to get here. I was afraid to fly. He said, that's the only way we're going to have you out here. And the rest is history. Ladies and gents, we just went on. And Lucy, we had 19 million sellers in a row.
Dave, you mentioned I'm walking. We're transcending the time scale a little bit. But let's hear an excerpt of one of Fats's greatest records.
Actually, John, how about one other thing? Dave, how did you come up with the idea for such a heavy backbeat on the Fat Man that made the record different from most of the other rhythm blues records back then?
Well, the late Earl Palmer was a great drummer as well as a dancer. And quite naturally, he made things that he could dance to because he was a professional dancer. At least he knew what was going on in everybody's step. And that made it perfect so people could dance to him. The great Earl Palmer with his different beats, an educated beat that would fit any tune that we wanted to do with.
Yeah. So let's hear I'm Walking.
Well, I'm
Earl
walking.
Earl Palmer.
Well, okay, now you're asking me what I'm walking. Bump, tick, bump, tick, bump, ba-dum, jump, bump, tick, bump. We took it off the street and brought it inside. That's what I was trying to tell you, that the great Earl Palmer, the average band that is actually playing on the streets, bump, tink, bump, tink, bump, tink, bum, jump, bump, jump, bump, jump, bump. Earl Palmer was a dancer and a hell of a drummer. And quite natural, he mastered that. That's how we got the beat on I'm Walking and all the other tunes that we were instrumental in doing. Also, Josephine. I'm getting relayed a question over here.
Talking about you and me, I'm hoping that you come back.
That's what I'm talking about. That's the late. I'm sorry, that's Herbert Hardesty. Our great saxophonist, Mr. Herbert Hardesty. That was cut in Philadelphia. At that time, we were playing at the Showboat. And we would, one evening, we were just clowning around and singing and playing and having fun. I'll never forget, it was a Sunday evening. And we're just clowning everything. And all at once, we just saying, I'm clunking. Somebody had something else. And that we had what is called at that time, one of the great guitars of all time, a young man called Papoose. And he just fell in. And we just started from one thing, just jamming. That's the way I'm Walking was made. One of those times, just having a lot of good time. We didn't have the right words and all that. We just started clowning. That was all. There was a place called Pep's right around the corner from the Showboat on Lombard and Broad. So you might say, well, how do you know about Lombard and Broad? Because the Showboat was there, and that was more or less like home to us. That was our home base in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. So that's the way I'm Walking really born. And we actually finished it in Mr. Cosmo's studio about a week or 2 weeks after that. I'd like to say a little bit about Fats Domino and Blueberry Hill. We were in Hollywood at the time, and Antoine said, that's what I call Fats, that is his name, Antoine Domino. He said, I want to do Blueberry Hill. We was in the studio, we went in there, this flat, we didn't have really anything in mind. We usually playing something when we go in there. Mr. Matassa, we was lost without you. We was in Hollywood. Because he would say, well, why don't you try this and so and so? But Fats said, I want a Blueberry Hill. Well, his uncle, Harrison Verrett, at the time, the late Harrison Verrett, well, he played guitar. He said, well, I can help, but I don't know the middle. It's better known as the bridge. of the song. I said, I don't know it myself. I don't know the changes. So Fat said, well, I'm going to sing. I got that. Sure enough, just one tune that day. Oh, we went in there like, man, about 10 o'clock that morning, 10 o'clock at night, we still don't have nothing. We're in Hollywood. So I said, well, okay, let's try this. And Bunchy said, that was his name, Bunchy, like our drummer, Bunchy. But he was Bunny. Bunny said, look, what you do the first 16 bars, and do the 8 by itself, which is better known as the bridge, the middle. I said, well, okay. So I said, well, you know, I don't know the song, but I'm going to write a passing tone. Da 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 da. That's what I wrote. So, okay, we sang that. The bunny put together, sure it come out. But when he put in, he cut the tape. Well, something like that. I said, man. So Lou called me and said, what you got? I threw it on his desk. I said, a piece of shit. And so what happened, in my office at that time was Orleans Claiborne, and I was over going tuxedo shop. My office was upstairs. So he called me about 6 months later and said, what you doing? I said, ain't nothing going on, you know. He wanted if I pick up new talent. I said, well, I'll tell you what I did. That's what he told me. He said, go downtown, it's any kind of car you want. Any kind of Cadillac you want. You know we like Cadillacs. I said, what you talking about, man? He said, I just released Blueberry Hill, and we done shipped over 100,000. I said, what? He said, yeah. I said, how about the bridge? But when on the original record, da-da-da, like that, you know, and then kept on going, you know, da-da-da-da. Man, this is the luckiest thing in the world for me to do. And so, and the rest is history. It did about $4 million. Now, this is what actually happened. On the Bandbox was next door to Birdland down. It's a basement club in New York City. So we usually play Birdland, but Fasten got too big for Birdland. We playing at the Bandbox. The people walking in packed in jam. Well, here come the owners. A Blueberry Hill. They hadn't had a hit since Louis Armstrong. It wasn't Louis Armstrong. At that time, I was 30 years old, and I'm 60 then. How you doing, Fast? Thank you, Fast. You know? I was saying, this a bitch. I done worked like a goddamn dog all day long on this shit in Hollywood. You gonna talk about Fats. And I done put the song together. And I'm still sitting there, you know? He said, well, who's faster? Yeah, you know. And I said, the hell with you. And that's all I ever got. I didn't get shit for Blue Hill. As big as that song was. That's right. So a lot of time will ask me about the publishing. If you write a song, people out there, be sure and get what's due you, because I did an awful lot of work for people. Now, Lou Shedden, when I met him, although I know he's dead now, if he's living, I tell him the same thing. He did not do me a favor. When I met him, he didn't have a pot to piss in. Excuse my French. But the main thing about it, never really appreciated what I was doing. And after I got out of the record business with him, he came back after he sold the company in Las Vegas. Asked me if I would go back with him again. I said no, but it's just one of those type of things. Usually a hard luck story like that, no, most people don't want to tell it, but me, I got to tell it just like it is. Ron, my youngest son, who actually managed me and tell me what to do, guess what he told me? Now, you know you're going up there now. Don't be sassy. They're right there. But that's not sassy, it's just being authentic. He's just telling it like it is. I done got to be this age and everything. I must have had somebody to take care of my kids, really take care of me over there. And I want everybody to know they've been very good to me, good kids. Everybody can't say they had a lot of good kids. Thank you.